what I want to do is I want to start and just give you a little bit of a flavour of the history of car sales, sort of where we've come from, what have been the pivots that the business has made over the course of our history. I'll give you a little bit of an insight in terms of performance and how the business has evolved from a performance point of view. I'll talk a little bit about strategy as well, what our overall strategy looks like. I'll also attempt to do a product demonstration as well. And there, I mean, for those of you in technology, you know that's quite risky in this sort of an environment. But I'm going to have a go. And then what I'll do is, I always find it's interesting to understand, you know, all the things that have worked in an organisation, but what are things that haven't worked and why haven't they worked? They're always quite interesting to hear about as well. So I'll try and talk to you about some of those as well. But what I'd like to do first is maybe start with a quick short video just to give you a bit of an insight in terms of the culture of the business and how we sort of operate. So if we could start with that, that'd be great.
I've been reading books of old, the legends and the myths, Achilles and his gold, Hercules and his gifts, Spider-Man's control and Batman with his fist. And clearly I don't see myself upon that list. But she said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss. Just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this. Something just like this. Testaments they told, the moon and its eclipse, and Superman unrolls the suit before he lived. But I'm not the kind of person that it fits. She said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss. Just something I can turn to, somebody I can miss. I want something just like this.
I think I'm a good driver, I really do. Is it car parking? That's not good. Oh, Jesus. This is my wife's Mazda CX-9.
A confetti machine. 150 kilometers per hour.
The chair turns into a toilet.
And the myths, the testaments they told, the moon and its eclipse, and Superman unrolls the suit before he lived. But I'm not the kind of person that it fits. She said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss. Just something I can turn to, somebody I can miss. I want something just like this.
Thank you. Well, car sales reaches more buyers than anywhere else, but usually I just stand next to it and smile until someone offers to buy it.
So that's just a little bit of an insight on our business in terms of its culture. So if I've left you with the impression that all we do is do golf days and yoga, eat pizza, I've probably left you the wrong impression. But certainly, you know, we're a business that likes to have fun, and we've evolved nicely that way. In terms of us as a business, we're obviously an online marketplace. We have both buyers and sellers on both sides of the transaction. And I hope many of you in the room tonight have used car sales many times as either a buyer or a seller. But also on the sell side, we also have a number of dealers that are customers too. So, you know, franchise dealers, and there are, you know, well over 1,000 franchise dealerships in Australia, and non-franchise dealers are also customers. We have a lot of OEMs in this country, a lot of car manufacturers. There's over 60 here in Australia, and even in the US, there's mid to high 40s. So it's the Australian car market is actually a more competitive market than many of the markets overseas. And most of those car companies are customers of car sales as well. So just quickly, want to talk to you about our culture in our business. So the culture of our business is very much focused on innovation. It's at the core of everything we do. We focus on a principle that is that not one person or one team in our organisation is responsible for innovation. It's a responsibility of all of us to innovate in our company, and we've had great track record and success with that over the many years that we've been around. So what I want to do just quickly is just replay a little bit of history for you and talk to you about how we've evolved as a business, and in that process talk to you about some of the pivots that we've had to go through and adapt to over time as well. So looking around the room, there's probably a few of you that were here in 1997, and in 1997 the way we bought and sold cars was via print advertising. So I remember on a Saturday morning I'd get out of bed and go down to the news agent and buy a copy of the Age. I'd take it home and grab a texter out, and I'd look for the sort of car I was looking to buy. And when I was at university, I was looking to buy a Ford Escort. And I'd be looking through Ford Escorts and circling all the ones that were in my sort of price range. I'd be jumping on the phone and asking the seller if it was the one with the alloy wheels or the one with the leather seats. And the process I'd have to go through is then to drive out to every one of them and sort of work out which one I wanted to buy. And it was an enormously inefficient process. It took weeks and weeks and weeks to get through that. As a seller, when I had a little BMW 318i, which is a great little car, but I decided to get rid of it. And I placed my ad in a newspaper, and it cost me $63 for a weekend. And I didn't managed to sell it that weekend. I had to re-advertise again for a couple of weekends before I actually get it sold. So the model was a subscription base. You paid for the weekend and you just kept going until you sold your vehicle. On the dealer side of it, it was very similar too. It was a subscription-based model. So a dealer would pay for one car or they'd pay for 50 cars. And it was, you know, it was a trust us, it'll be great sort of model where, you know, if you didn't sell the cars that you're advertising that weekend, yeah, you'd be back again the following weekend. So a really inefficient model. In 1997 too, there was a little company in Mount Waverley in Melbourne, on Blackburn Road in Mount Waverley, called Reynolds & Reynolds. And Reynolds & Reynolds, what they do is they build computer systems for car dealers. And at the time, the Reynolds & Reynolds guys, they were trying to figure out how they could evolve a platform that enabled dealers to swap parts, spare parts for their service centres. Their service centres, you know, if you've got a vehicle that you're trying to get serviced and the service centre doesn't have those parts, you know, our geographic isolation can sometimes make parts quite hard to track down, and if you've got to wait 2 or 3 days to get parts, that can be a problem. So what they decided to do was to build this network and enable dealers to swap parts, and it worked really, really well. What they then decided to do was to evolve it even further and enable dealers to swap cars. So through this same closed network, and it didn't work. It didn't work anywhere near the same way. And it was because if one car dealer had a great car, a really nice, black 318i BMW, they knew that sooner or later a consumer would come and buy that car and they'd be able to make a good gross margin out of that vehicle. So it didn't quite work. So what they decided to do was to publish all that inventory that the dealers supplied them with onto this thing called the internet. And car sales, that is actually the first version of car sales in 1997. And at the end of 1997, we had 2,000 cars on car sales. But it worked really quite well because what they did was they built an interface between the dealer's computer systems and the website. So, rather than having to manually load and create ads and load up stock and so on, it was a far simpler and automated process. And another thing with the internet was, because it wasn't a city by city classifieds approach, it was you're actually now seeing the 2,000 cars that are available across Australia. So the model completely changed at that point. Roll forward to 1998. So we had 4,000 cars on the site at the end of 1998, and we made some changes. As you can see, we made quite a few changes to the website. But the most important changes that we made were we built a search engine. So if you look at the top of the page there, you'll see four boxes which enabled consumers to find the vehicles they're looking for much easier. And the other thing we did was we started to allow private sellers to advertise their cars. So if you look down the bottom right-hand side there, you'll see it was same model as a subscription-based model in print, which was for $29 for 60 days, you could advertise your car. At the end of that 29 days, it would, or in the 60 days, it would cost you another $29. I think we also threw in a free mouse pad and calculator, which was a bonus, right? And the model was starting to evolve, but in terms of the economics of the model, it was very similar to our print classified competitors, which was subscription based for dealer and time based for consumers. Roll forward to 2001, 2002, and these were tough years for us. So we actually became a public unlisted company in 2000, and we did it right in time for the tech wreck to land on us. Virtually in the same month the tech wreck landed, which caused us no end of pain in trying to raise capital. But nonetheless, we pushed forward. What we were finding was things were getting tough, and we got down to probably our last $600,000 as an organisation. We had to make some changes. Our private seller model, as I mentioned, was the same as our print classified competitors. And when you looked at the trade and talked to the dealers, they were saying to us that we're not getting leads, or we're not getting opportunities to sell cars from you guys. And it was a real problem for us. So things had to change. We had to pivot. And I guess the big change that we made was more of a philosophical one to start with, which was that our job as a company isn't to advertise cars. Our job is to help our customers sell their cars. You think, that doesn't seem like a big shift, but it is a big shift in terms of approach to our customer base. And we had to innovate in order to turn things around. So what we did was made a number of changes. And on the private seller side, which is on the left-hand side, and these screens aren't great because they're really old. But on the left-hand side there, what we did was we moved from a subscription-based model of paying for time to saying, well, our job for private sellers is until our private sellers have got a result, until they've sold their car, we haven't done our job. So, the model moved from subscription to what we call pay once, list until sold, which is what we have today. So, $10 is all it will cost you. And whether it takes a day, a week, a month, or a year for us to sell your car, that's all it's going to cost you. Another thing we realised was what's important for sellers is to get not just a good result in terms of selling their car, but to try and do it fast. And the way we try and do it fast is by introducing more audience So how do we bring more of an audience to our private sellers? So what we did was what we call distribution deals with other platforms. So you may see Yahoo up there. So Yahoo, we did a distribution deal, which meant all of our inventory was published on the Yahoo site. Consumers could find it. And that worked really well for us. On the trade side of things, I mentioned before that customers were saying to us that they weren't getting good opportunities and enough of them from us to sell cars, and that was a real problem for us, because with a subscription-based model, it's hard to know how many leads or opportunities I'm actually giving to my customers, and so we had to make some pretty dramatic changes at that point in time. So the things that we did, and there was quite a few of them, but the most important things that we did was we actually changed the website. So you used to be able to go to the site, find a dealer car, you'd know who the dealer was and where the dealer was located. That would leak opportunities because consumers would just ring direct or they'd go straight to the dealership. So we made the site what we call blind. And what that means is if you're looking at a dealer car, you'll be able to search in a radius that suits your requirements around how far you're prepared to travel. You'll find your car, but you won't know exactly what dealership that car's located on until you inquire on that car. And we put a web form there and enabled consumers to inquire on it. And that was successful. The next thing we did was we said, okay, so now we know how many inquiries we're generating for our customer base, which is great. But to come back to that same principle of how many cars are we selling, what sort of result are we generating for our customers, we needed to find out. So one of the ways we did that was we started to survey our customers. So customer sends an inquiry to a dealer, we would survey them and ask them, did you buy that car from a dealer or did you buy another car from the dealer? And all of a sudden, now we know the numbers of inquiries that we're sending to our customers. We also now know roughly what sort of results we're generating for them. And that was interesting, but it required even more change. We had to then build what we call a lead management system for our dealers, because we're now providing them with opportunities to sell cars, but they need the platform in which to manage those inquiries in. So we built a platform called AutoGate, which all of our dealers today use, or most of them use, to manage leads. So lead would come in off the site, it'd be date stamped and time stamped, and the dealer could manage that through their organisation over time. And that was important. The other thing that was important was our field team. We need to change and evolve our field team. Our field team were used to going out and selling advertising to customers. Well, that needed to change. They needed to become performance managers. They needed to be able to converse with our customers around how they're actually performing on our website. So, how many detailed page views, how many search results, how many leads are you getting, what's your conversion rate doing, which cars are performing well, which cars aren't performing well. And the conversation changed substantially, and I think at that point we evolved from being an advertising business to being more of a business partner for those particular customers. And at the end of 2003, we had around about 40,000 cars on car sales at that point in time. Roll forward a bit to 2009, and 2009 was a big year for us in the business. We hit 150,000 cars listed on car sales. We IPO'd the business, and we just made the window for us to get our IPO away. We tried to list it the previous year in 2008, but most of you remember what happened in 2008. It was called the global financial crisis, and we had to pull the rug out from under that. And we just got the IPO away in time for the window to close again, probably late 2009. But we also, we launched our display advertising business. We launched our green car sales business. And there was a lot going on in that year. But one of the other things that also happened in that year, which was interesting, and I'll just explain the chart that you're actually looking at behind me. What that's actually looking at, the light blue would be the nearest traditional print classifieds competitor that we have that's listed on the ASX today, and that's looking at their market capitalization. And the blue bar is the pure play online classified companies of us, REA and Seek. And I can tell you that we are by far the smallest part of that little blue bar, that big blue bar there. REA and Seek have huge businesses. But the point is, that was the year when traditional print classifieds was permanently disrupted by digital players like us. And I guess sort of my personally looking back and reflecting on that and what that year actually meant to me personally, what were the sort of things that I learned in that year. There was quite a few. So one of them was, and we talk about this a lot at car sales, in our space, you need to win the consumer. If you win the consumer, you win the war. And we were very focused on building our traffic, building the quality of our traffic, and building our consumer experience through that process and building it up. The second thing that I learned was around disruption, and that is that I never want to be disrupted. But to not be disrupted, I think one of the things that you have to be is paranoid. You have to be really paranoid. And most of you out there that think you're not, your businesses aren't potentially being disrupted, you're all probably likely to be wrong. There'll be something going on in the background somewhere. You know, we were just a little computer system company in Blackburn Road in Mount Waverley that managed to disrupt a whole bunch of businesses. So I learned that, you know, being paranoid is really important. And the other thing I learned was being prepared to disrupt yourselves. You know, as a business, it's one thing to be disrupted, but if you do it to yourself, at least you know, you're in control of your own destiny. And as an organisation, there's been quite a few occasions where we've really tried hard to try and disrupt ourselves. And the fourth thing I learned was, you know, I had this view that as companies were disrupted, value would just move from the incumbent to the disruptor. But I guess what I've learned is, you know, value can accrete to the disruptor as well if the disruptor is adding value to the consumer. So if you're adding incremental value, you will always increase your value over time, and that's what you're really seeing there. So 2009 was an interesting year for us. Just while talking about performance, and I don't want to spend too much time on numbers, but as you can see there, as a business, that's just looking at our domestic revenue over time. So 2005 through to 2017. I guess the point I wanted to make there was obviously the business has grown, but what's been important to us as a business is also to diversify, and you'll hear me talk about that when I come to our strategy. And so the dark blue component there is our dealer revenue. And as you sort of move around from the bottom, you've got private seller, display advertising, a data business. We do a lot of data. And we have a business called Stratton Finance that we own part of, which is in the consumer private-to-private brokerage space. I mentioned before that one of the things that's been really important to us is you win the consumer, you win the war. And we take nothing for granted in our organisation, but you know, what is important to us, and you would have seen it through the video, brand, making sure our brand is front of mind, building our traffic, whether it's through traditional advertising channels or whether it's through performance-based channels, is always important to us. So SEM, SEO, those sorts of places, and obviously we've built up a very big and loyal audience over time. So, look, I mentioned before the aha moment that we had many years ago when we moved from thinking about being just advertising to selling, and the pivot that took in terms of us as an organisation, and just thinking about that a little bit more clearly. So as a business, we didn't just innovate around product, and most companies, you know, think innovation is around product. It's not. In our business, we had to innovate around business process. So we had to move our business process from being sub-based to being opportunity-based, which was a huge change. We had to change all of our user experience on the site to cater for how the site now functions. We had to re-educate our field team in terms of reteaching them how to sell to a dealer and how to communicate with a dealer, because you know, the conversations that we would have with a dealer evolved to, when a dealer advertises a car, it's about how many photos you put on the site against your car. It's about taking high quality photos, taking lots of them because a photo sells a car. It's about pricing your car to market because with the emergence of online, pricing transparency is there now. It never used to be, but it's there now with online. We've got to move with the times. It's about describing the car properly and responding to consumers as they're inquiring on those vehicles. Because what happens now is consumers will they will research and they'll spend time figuring out the sort of car they want to buy, and they'll use online marketplaces like car sales to do that. And they'll filter. They'll filter down from models and makes down to specific cars that they want to look at buying. And they can be in and out of the market inside a day or several hours, particularly if they're on their mobile phone in a coffee shop on a Saturday morning looking at cars. Well, let's go and have a look at one of these today, and they could be out of the market straight away. So we've had to teach our dealers, it's all about how quickly you respond. And we know that if you respond to an inquiry inside half an hour, you're much more likely to get a sale than if you don't. And so all those things were really important to us. But the other thing that changed and evolved over time was the consumer experience as well on our site, which helped. So when a dealer sold a car, they would remove it from the site straight away because they didn't want to pay for more inquiries on that car if it was sold. They'd take lots of photos because they didn't want to take inquiries on, is this the one with the 21-inch alloys or the leather seats? And from a consumer experience, that's great because I'm not having to ask those questions. And they'd respond really quickly to me because they wanted to be able to sell a car. So the behaviour's all changed. But the other things that we've been thinking about as an organisation over the years as part of this whole buy-sell ownership ecosystem that we're a part of is thinking more around frictionless, and you'll see that word at the bottom of that slide. But when we talk about frictionless, what that means is how do we remove friction from the process of buying and selling a car? And we all know there's friction points in there, like that moment where you're handing over a check and someone's handing over the keys, you're going, oh my God, I hope this car drives on me, or I hope it doesn't have any mechanical issues. They're all points of friction. So as an organisation, we think a lot more today around how do we remove those friction points. And what I want to do is, when I get to my demonstration, I'll demonstrate for you one of the things that we've been working on over the last several months to reduce friction points in that buy-sell process. So look, a little bit about strategy. Our strategy is pretty simple, not overly complex. It's changed and pivoted a lot over time as the business has evolved. But on the left-hand side of that diagram there, you'll see our major customer segments. So major customer segments being corporates or dealers and OEMs and banks and insurance companies, they're all customers of ours. And then consumers, the consumer side of things as well. So private sellers, et cetera, et cetera. On the right hand side are our high level strategic pillars. And so the way we think about strategy at a really high level is we think about the evolution of our core business. I didn't mention it before, or maybe I did, but I just can't remember now. But when we talk about innovation in car sales, we make minor changes. We never think about making 100% change to anything we do. We make incremental, rapid 1% changes to everything we do all the time. And so when we think about our core business, it's about how do we keep making those changes? How do we keep evolving our customer experience and improving on what we're doing and evolving that way? The second element is around adjacent markets. So how do we extend or deepen our core offering through the application of adjacency? So over the past sort of several years now, we've gotten into things like I mentioned, the Stratton Finance Brokerage company that plays in the private-to-private space. We have an inspection business, a tyre business, and they all form part of our overall ecosystem. And then our strategy is, okay, so if we've got all that, that's great. Where's the future going? What are the future opportunities that we need to be thinking about and evolving over time? Things like data and there's lots of other evolution in our space at the moment, which I'm sure many of you are aware of, which we think about. So what I want to talk about now, just quickly, is I mentioned before, innovation is at our core, and you know, we've evolved quite rapidly, and it's all about trying to remove friction points from the buy sell process. Any of you guys see the Google demonstration the other day of a product called Duplex? Right. What I'm going to demonstrate is nothing like Duplex, right? So let's just get that out there right now. We don't have a $16 billion R&D budget. We just have passionate people that love our business and love what they do. And so what I want to talk to you about and show you is one of the issues that people have when they go to load their car onto a site like Car Sales is vehicle recognition, understanding what car they actually have. So many cars get misrepresented because the owner of the car doesn't really know what they've got. And as a buyer looking at that car, that can mean, you know, several thousand dollars in difference. So one of the friction points is around car identification. And you know, we've been focused on how do we make that far more seamless for our consumers. And how do we use the technology that we've got around image recognition and you know, our data itself. So how do we bring all that together and create a neat solution for our consumers? So I was in Sydney last week and I was doing a presentation. I was walking through a car park trying to work out what car I would do this demonstration on. And I found this one. It was just parked in a nice, neat car park. And it's a really lousy photo, which is kind of sort of good. And what I want to do is I'll demonstrate for you how this technology works. It's called Cyclops. And effectively, all I'm going to do is take a photo, and hopefully you'll hear the phone tell me what that car is. And if it doesn't work, I'm really sorry, but I've tried, okay?
I'm sure it is Subaru Outback SUV Series 4 Gen Badge 2.0D Premium.
So that's a relief, it worked. So nothing like Duplex, like it won't order a hairdressing salon, or it won't order a, or help me set myself up for a meal, but we think it's pretty cool. Look, one of the other things that sort of comes up when people go to place an ad for a car is around how do they sort of sell that car in terms of its images. So this next car here, anyone know what that is? People know what it is. Yeah, well done. Yep. It's a black Ford EcoSport, but it's actually a 2008 black Ford EcoSport Trend BL MY18, and all that stuff can make a difference in terms of the way a car is valued. It's worth about $24,000. So if anyone's looking at buying one of those, I think there's someone from Ford here that would be happy to take your order. Look, what happens, customers go to place their cars on our site and they take photos. They take lots of photos. And they load their photos up onto our site. And that first image there is what we call the hero shot. The hero shot is the first image that a consumer will see when they're doing a search. That one's the one that you need to have the right image of the car. And what Cyclops can do is it can identify all the images that you're taking of your car and work out, one, which images you're missing, and work out which image you should have for your hero shot, just by using the data science that the guys and the technology that the guys have developed. So I was talking to Alex before and saying, Alex, mate, if that was your car, would you put your hero shot as the interior of your car? And no one would do that, but some people do. And so Cyclops is actually telling the advertiser that they shouldn't be using that shot, they should be using another shot. It's also telling the customer that they're actually missing some images and they need to take those images in order for the consumer to get a full perspective on you know, what that car is all about and how it's made up and the condition that the car is in, et cetera, et cetera. And so the customer's taken the advice of Cyclops and now it's repositioned all the images so that it's now got the right images in the right order and will now maximise the opportunity for the customer to sell their car. So you know, all this sort of stuff is really important to us. It's important to how we're evolving as a business, and it goes again to these points of friction. Now, I meant to change the order of this slide. I meant to go up a few slides, but as a business car sales, we've been in the domestic market since 1997. But over the years, we've also expanded offshore. And our strategy offshore is to look for high growth markets where we can apply our technology and we can develop new versions of car sales in those high growth markets. So for us over the last several years, the regions that have had the most interest to us are the Latin American markets. And maybe you saw in that video, we actually have 80 people at car sales learning Spanish, which is no good if you're in Brazil, but it's good everywhere else in Latin America. And so, you know, building our positions in those markets are very important to us, because we look at a market like Australia and we sell here roughly about 1.2 million new cars a year. We sell roughly 3 million used cars a year. A market like Brazil, outside a recession, is doing 4 million new cars a year and about 11 million used cars a year. It's the fourth largest car market in the world. So the strategy is, how do we take our tech, apply it into those high growth offshore markets? So I said to you at the start of the presentation that one of the things I wanted to cover was just, you know, we've talked about all the things that have worked well and how we've evolved as a business, but what are the things that probably haven't worked quite the way we wanted them to? And, you know, there's a few. So the top left-hand side there is a business we started in 2008. It's a business called Home Sales. And the value proposition of Home Sales was, REA and Domain very strong in the agent market. But if you looked at markets like Italy and you looked at markets like Canada, they're big, they have big representations of private to private. In some of those markets, private to private is about 30% of the overall market. So consumers are quite comfortable in selling their homes in those markets. So we thought, well, yeah, I mean, we're good at helping the people that own their things sell their things. Yeah, we do that with our customers now. Can we apply that same logic to something like a home sales? And the answer is no, you can't. We launched home sales. We got to probably around 7,000 or so homes after many years, and we thought we got to do something here. So we pivoted, and we pivoted back to, you know, the likes of what the traditional digital guys were doing, and we became a me3. And, you know, in a marketplace like this, you can't be a me3. You have to have a strong point of competitive difference. And so it just didn't work for us. In 2009, we saw a Prius come into the market, and we knew that the world was going to go green. We knew, you know, EV, hydrogen, based cars were someday going to be more represented in the market. You know, we just had IMEV, which is a Mitsubishi car, a small little Mitsubishi car, and Honda had a hybrid, and then there was just the Toyota Prius. And so what we thought we would do is, so maybe we can carve out a niche market, and so let's build another version of car sales and call it green car sales. But again, we just couldn't get scale. I mean, you know, people will go to a site where there's the most inventory, and we have around about 237,000 cars on our site now, and when you've only got 3,000 IMEVs and Priuses, it's not quite that compelling. So that didn't work for us. On the right-hand side there, in 2006, we prototyped a business when we were in our little office in Oakley. And it was a general classifieds business, and you know, we thought it was pretty cool, but we didn't really do anything with it, and it pulled some reasonable inventory. A lot of people that were selling number plates liked to use it for some reason, but we didn't feed it, and we just let it grow and evolve, and the general classifieds market, come to 2010, 2011, evolved. But we didn't do anything with quick sales until it was 2011, 2012. And so we were probably too late to market. So timing in that one was everything, and we had an opportunity, but we just didn't get the timing of it right. And the same would be said for Pitchy. So Pitchy, that was a great concept. It was general classifieds using video, So, you know, you would take a video of whatever it was you were selling and you'd drop it onto Pitchy. And so we accumulated a lot of really cool stuff for sale. Like one of the things that was for sale, I bought quite a few of them. It was like a beach towel that the Americans had developed in Iraq to stop sand blowing into the engines of their helicopters. So helicopters would land, they'd put like a big beach mat down, and the sand wouldn't blow up into their engines. And some unique guy decided to turn those into beach towels. And they were really cool because you put them down, you'd go for a swim, come back, and there'd be no sand on your towel. And we sold lots of these things. But it didn't quite work for us. But it was a cool concept. And if you think of the likes of Instagram and where they could go one day with video classifieds potentially, you go, well, Pitchy was probably a precursor to that. So there's some of the things that probably haven't worked out quite as well as what we'd like. But you know, as an organisation, our philosophy is to develop products, get them into market, let the market test them. If the market likes them, then we'll feed them, we'll keep evolving them and building them out. And if they fail, then we'll pull them. So it's about failing fast in order to succeed sooner, if you've heard that saying before. And that's how we think about the world at car sales. So I think that's it. I guess the few things I'd like to leave you guys with today, if I reflect on our business and how we think about the world and what's important to us as a culture, what are the real sticking cultural elements that Greg, as the founder of the business, introduced to all of us many years ago, and they've stuck like glue. The three P's that we always think about. So, you know, the passion. Our business. All the people inside our business are extremely passionate about what we do. We love what we do. We love our customers. We love, you know, how our market's evolving and changing. Paranoia is the other P. You know, we are a paranoid business, and we're always looking for those competitive threats and where they might come from and how we might respond and, you know, those sorts of things. Because again, we don't want to have happen to us what happened to our competitors in the day. And the third thing is perseverance. So, you know, it's about never giving up. It's about always being prepared to try and do different things. And if they don't work the first time, pivot, evolve, change, and do it rapidly until you hopefully get a better result. But hopefully I haven't gone over time. But thanks so much for listening to me today, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you.